ரைட்டர்ஸ், போயட்ஸ், அகடமிஷியன்ஸ், எஜுகேஷனிஸ்ட், ஜர்னலிஸ்ட், சோஷியல் ஆக்டிவிஸ்ட். இட்ஸ் ஏ ஸ்ட்ரேஞ்ச் காம்பினேஷன். ஐ ஸ்டாண்ட் பிஃபோர் யூ இன் திஸ் கிரேட் லேண்ட் ஆஃப் திருவள்ளூர், சுப்பிரமணிய பாரதி, பெரியார், அண்ட் கலைஞர். ஐ ஸ்டாண்ட் பிஃபோர் யூ அட் தி இன்ஸ்டன்ஸ் ஆஃப் தமிழ்நாடு ப்ரோக்ரெசிவ் ரைட்டர்ஸ் அண்ட் ஆர்டிஸ்ட் அசோசியேஷன். Therefore, though there is little communication gap because I can't, I can understand, but I really can't follow the purport and the meaning of the speeches delivered in Tamil, but I am proud to be here. Dravidian movement, it has undergone its own trials and tribulations, but many a times has proven to be a forerunner to the events. And I hope and trust it will play same role now at this critical juncture of Indian polity. I have seen the response, very well drafted response of DMK and CPM and Tamil Nadu Progressive writers to the draft. I could have as well said that I agree with them and I concur with them and then leave the matter there. But I have come all the way to interact with you, and I would not like to lose this opportunity to say few words. At the very outset, let me place and record my gratitude and being invited to present my views about the draft new education policy 2019. I recognize the immense honor that has been bestowed on all of us to be invited to contribute our ideas towards development of a comprehensive new education policy that can enrich the genius and the capacities of every citizen of this country as fully self-actualized human beings, and through such enrichment pursue the task of taking forward the path of national progress. I would hasten to add that it is our duty to participate in this debate. Nay, I will say that it is a duty that is accompanied by a sense of being privileged to be of service to the people of this nation. At this stage itself, let me also express my strong sense of deja vu that I experienced upon reading the draft NEP 2019, of having heard many of the same sentiments being previously expressed in the report of the first Education Commission, popularly known as Kothare Commission, way back in mid-1960s. I must also confess to being underwhelmed as I read through draft, though I must hasten to add there are few different elements of the draft NEP that do recommend themselves as being necessary for building a progressive educational climate. The first cause for dismay is that near absence of any reference to Kothare Commission in the draft. I would not, of course, suggest that such a reference ought to have been made in some ritualistic sense. If indeed it is perceived by later generations that an earlier text is of little or no value, then indeed it need not even be fully reiterated, much less even followed. However, when the earlier text had outlined sets of problems that are eerily similar to what we have begun to re-articulate again some 5.5 decades later, then it is epistemologically and hence ethically necessary to take a look at what did happen with the original policy and what went wrong, surely acknowledgement of history. And a record of successes and failures of social endeavors across its course, and the only laboratory of empirical knowledge how societies organize themselves, culturally ought to be a vital component of the moral ground of an endeavor to frame a new education policy. The non-recognition of how similar problem statements is now to what it was 5.5 decades earlier surely must raise our eyebrows as to whether we are inadvertently out of hubris, missing out in analyzing what went wrong with the framework suggested previously and the solutions engendered by such framework. From a methodological perspective, this shocking lapse in the draft NEP must make us wary about its claimed comprehensiveness. I will, in the short time allocated to me, delve into a few broad themes that we miss in the discussion regarding the draft. However, let me hasten to add that it is not my intention to suggest that the entire draft is to be binned or even that it cannot serve as a starting point for further refinement. Indeed, I must also place on record that NEP 2019 makes some or many suggestions, or at least recognizes some important structural elements that have gone missing from our national educational endeavors. The emphasis, for instance, on early childhood learning processes and the need to substantially reinforce them, presumably by provision for both material and cultural requirements of growing children to improve the access and the quality of educational outcomes of all children, irrespective of socio-economic class they belong to, and ought to be treated as vital component of the pragmatic portion of draft. To the many other sound and possibly necessary changes proposed, I would also commend the changes they have recommended to structure of university education, including but not limited to the elimination of the so-called specialized colleges, mostly in engineering and medicine, to be replaced by institutions which emphasize the need to locate the teaching, learning and research, even in sciences, as part of wider universe of learning, including social sciences and the humanities. The great emphasis placed on research is also to be welcomed. I have always held the opinion that the teacher who do not actively and passionately seek new knowledge cannot pass on to their students the necessary passions to pursue learning. Obviously, with all policy intentions, how effectively they are implemented would have an important bearing on whether such recommendations remain as mere pious declarations or bring about some substantial gains. I came away with a sense of unease, a foreboding of another missed opportunity to redefine our conception of education and its role in human emancipation from the shackles of ignorance. If education is cultural action for freedom, as Paulo Freire so evocatively defined, then surely how we conceive its role would have an important bearing upon what we think of as essential markers of human existence, as individuals and as groups, large and small. I think it is instructive to read the first three paragraphs of the Kothari Commission report from the mid-60s to frame what I think ought to be foundational aspects of any review of how we conceive education of our people, educational system, and what we expect from them. And I suspect they will also intimate to us the magnitude of our failures, leading to questions as to why we may have failed our people and why we repeatedly stumble upon the same set of limited perspectives that only enable us to conceive of the changes required as the tinkerers and evade the questions of moral urgency and existential purpose. I have referred to some of those recommendations which were made by the Kothari Commission. I don't read them. Most of you recognize that the same themes I've read had to be repeated ad nauseam in public discourse regarding education in India, even in recent times. The broad consensus has been that the overall quality of education we impart to most of our children is of an abysmally low quality. And it is underscored by repeated exhortations that instead of reaping the demographic dividend, we may turn youthful bulge in our demographic pyramid into a demographic curse if we do not use education to enable self-actualization as an essential element of development of individuals, groups of them, and the nation as a people as a whole. So it should not be a surprise when that more or less the same consensus will again necessarily also frame the debate about what the new education policy ought to look like. The structure of questions remain the same, from whether the schooling program should be defined so and so, the need for a Marshall Plan to invest the teacher education, then to remaking how one can become a teacher, and on a whole range of other issues that bear strange parallels and structural similarities. And that we are repeating more or less the same problem sets as the overarching frames of reference ought to make us pause to appropriate the tragedies that have been wrecked in the lives of our citizens by the manner in which we framed the questions of education in our policy documents. In an intellectually enervated manner, and then proceeded to, in any case, refrain from fully seeking to achieve even the simplistically framed programmatic goals. Actually, the right phrase to describe, given the huge swaths of humanity we have allowed to remain shackled by ignorance and hence continue to remain in the dehumanized state, would be a criminal neglect. Given the above and going beyond any quibble regarding nitty-gritty of policies being narrated, we necessarily have to ask, are we even framing the issue correctly? Are we visualizing the role we expect education to play in the lives of individuals and groups of them in a significantly incomplete manner? Are we by formulating the policy in purely or largely instrumental terms, primarily from the perspective of economic development, missing the spirit that we should seek when we address the issue of education in India? For Gandhi, education was less about achieving instrumental goals of equipping youngsters with the skills necessary to find productive employment, and more about transforming the character of Indians, redefine what it meant to be an Indian, and through such transformation, change the very manner in which the human beings live and experience themselves. Others in the society and the nature at large, when framed in this immediate questions, also arose as to the vileness of a hierarchical society that not only suppressed the economic and the political spheres, but also oppressed the masses by denying them their own humanity of being eligible to receive knowledge, use and modulate it for material, artistic, metaphysical, and even spiritual ends, and further develop it in its many variegated expressions and iterations. The primary task of education in this sense would then be to make the discovery of being human a journey of passion, of self-discovery, and of self-actualization, both at the individual level and also as members of collectives, and eliminate the inequities imposed by vile hierarchical social structures. That last point is very important. As Yuval Harari points out in his book Homo Sapiens, the success of human, the animal, was on account of being able to engender and use abstract concepts as frameworks for collective actions and infusing the social endeavors with great passion and commitments. At the point of our independence, we had amongst the many, we had set for ourselves one goal that was of the very essence of the task of building a nation of people, of liberating of our people from the dehumanized state that they found themselves to be in, substantially the result of the bestiality of the external masters and the venality of their native interlopers. Independence that was sought on Gandhian platform of Ahimsa Satyagraha could not thus be mere political contrivance. It had to be necessarily for those who cared about the humanity of each Indian citizen, the creation of a radically transformed people. You have to pose a question to yourself and discern as to whether any answer is provided for the questions which I have raised in this draft education policy. While the newly formed nation was being sought to be structured as a democracy founded on principles of egalitarianism, many skeptics had expressed a concern as to whether the country, in which most of the populace was illiterate, steeped in ignorance and squalor, with an average life expectancy of a mere 27-30 years, could succeed as democracy. Baba Saheb Ambedkar, justifiably and presciently, warned us that only an India that eliminated the contradictions between political equality on the one hand and the graded inequalities in social and economic spheres could be viable as a social democracy. The chief principle from its rich cultural heritage that Baba Saheb picked two words, phrases, were Aham Brahmasmi and Tattvamasi, as a marker that India had the cultural nous to construct a democracy that was far more genuine than what others had done so far. If one would view, according to Baba Saheb, these two Mahakavyas, not from the perspective of signifying a cosmic spiritual Brahman, but as signified of a shared universality, then the implications of socio-political actions are radical. The recognition of inherent dignity in every human being and the fraternity that emerges from recognition of a mutually in the protection of dignity of others would necessarily have to inform all modes of social and personal action. However, we must also recognize that given the hierarchies and the brutality of conflicts and oppression between different levels and the history of social and political violence spanning at least many, many hundreds of years that produced them, finding acceptance of the spirit of recognition of dignity in each other, irrespective of status of the other person and the past, is not something that can be achieved by trivial efforts or as a mere byproducts of pursuit of knowledge for economic ends. Skills to be able to work for the modern jobs, and even the attitudes and imaginations to produce newer artifacts of science and technology, howsoever necessary they may be, do not definitively or even necessarily lead to the development of a cultural value matrix that recognizes as an empathetic and a rational level the mutuality of dignity of human beings. If I may paraphrase the work of Amartya Sen, we need to recognize that there is enough technical knowledge amongst all human societies combined to solve most of the technical and material problems, to give to each and every human being enough of material resources to prevent their wasting away on account of lack of adequate material and cultural resources. The question then would be, if we state Sen's problems set in a different way about the value structures we evolved to enable us to both solve the material problems that confront us as individuals, individual societies, and as humanity, as well as construct the value frames that will enable us to make the right collective choices to be able to do so. That is, a value frame that seeks to instantiate at a primordial level the operation of the principle I have referred to above, or stated in our modern constitutional idiom, instantiation of indefeasible human dignity amongst all citizens and the groups of them which result in genuine fraternity as the platform for a social democracy, allowing our people to explore their natural genius as individuals and as collectives. Paulo Freire, who was a great Brazilian educationist, concerns regarding the dehumanized conditions of both the oppressed and the oppressors, and the need to reinforce the movements towards humanization of both would serve as well as the starting points to reimagine what education in India 2019 as a cultural action for freedom might look like. It may be, I submit, very instructive to reiterate two passages with which he framed the question of pedagogy of the oppressed. While the problem of humanization has always, I quote him, from an axiological point of view, being humankind's central problem, it now takes on the character of an inescapable concern. Concern for humanization leads at once to the recognition of dehumanization, not only as an ontological possibility, but as a historical reality. Within history, its concrete objective context, both humanization and dehumanization are possible for the persons as uncompleted beings conscious of their incompletion. But while humanization and dehumanization are real alternatives, only the first is people's avocation. vocation. This vocation is constantly negated by injustice, oppression, and the violence of the oppressor. It is affirmed by the yearning of the oppressed for freedom and justice, and by their struggle to recover their lost humanity. Dehumanization, which marks not only those whose humanity has been stolen, but also, though in a different way, those who have stolen it, as a distortion of the vocation of becoming more fully human, because it's a distortion of being more fully human. Sooner or later, being less human leads to the oppressed to struggle against those who made them so. In order for this struggle to have meaning, the oppressed must not, in seeking to regain their humanity, which is a way to create it, become in turn oppressors of the oppressors, but rather restorers of humanity of both. In the Indian context, given its own particular set of circumstances, of graded inequalities, of a hierarchically ordered society that become vicious in its impact of those on the bottom and its history, massive dehumanization would have necessarily followed a revolutionary and violent quest for equality. Consequently, the transformative potential to move to establishing humanization as the primary vocation of the people within the oppressed masses in India could and can only be possible if education as a cultural action for freedom foregrounds such a goal as the primordial foundation for social action by individuals, groups of them, and larger collectives. We don't find any answers for these questions in the new education policy. Unfortunately, by viewing education from a purely instrumental perspective, Unfortunately, by viewing education from a purely instrumental perspective of meeting the needs of the markets or the planned developmental state, we lost an opportunity in the early years of our republic to lay the foundations for progressing towards an egalitarian order marked by the vocation of humanization. This has had very serious consequences to how the nation state provisioned for education of its citizens. Lacking the moral content, education as a national endeavor lacked the appropriate moral urgency. The consequent tragedies that unfolds before us under the onslaught of a neoliberal order that seeks to define humans as nothing more than greedy and self-contained monarchs are all too glaringly visible from an impending environmental catastrophe and frustrating incapacities to order our value priorities as human beings in making collective choices to prevent the disaster, to incapacities at defining norms for evaluation and acceptability of truth, claims, all amidst the horror of lost humanity of most of the people. Whether we can forestall an environmental disaster or not, it is clear that the failure of our educational system is not foregrounding the mutuality of indefeasible human dignity of all the primordial objectives has allowed depredatory cultures of I, me, and mine to take deep root. And as we carrying towards the need to mitigate the impact of environmental disaster created by a culture of greed is good and consumerism without concern for impact of those being left behind, we will also increasingly have to call upon instincts and values of mutuality, of a humanistic impulse for humanization, to craft ethically viable collective action choices. Technocrats will always have their place, as the products of human ingenuity have demonstrated great power to solve many problems. The one problem they have not been good at solving are the problems of values that should undergird our choices as individuals and as collectives in the shared space of mutuality, of human dignity that we ought to be creating. There is another theme that troubles me. As a lawyer and having served on the bench for over 2 decades, it is my instinct to be worried about the implications for the constitutional structure. We are living in the times where constitutional structures are being altered by presidential decrees. This new educational policy for me has a serious implications so far as the federal structure of this country is concerned. There are any number of proposals in the draft NEP to set up various national level bodies to oversee the implementation of the proposed policy. Based on a reading of the text of the draft, it appears that maybe the committee did not have the resources, and maybe it wasn't even their mandate to reflect on how various federal principles of our constitution might be implicated. For instance, one of the recommendations is to set up an apex body headed by the Prime Minister and involving a few select chief ministers. The draft, of course, does not go on to explain how those selected chief ministers will be so designated and chosen, and how those few select chief ministers might be empowered to speak on behalf of the chief ministers not deemed to be selected, or even those states or regions not deemed to be select. This, I think, would ultimately lead the stature of the states reduced to mere appendages or satellites, or at the most a glorified municipality to implement the decision taken by some and somewhere. This has very dangerous implications for the federal structure of the Constitution. This requires a further detailed discussion, deeply analyzing not only the structure but also the intent of the recommendations made, because some are implicit and some are explicit. What are those implicit in this policy? What is that ultimately these policy makers intend to achieve? But coming back to the question, education should be liberal, எஜுகேஷன் ஷுட் பி லிபரல், பட் ஐ டோன்ட் ஃபைண்ட் எனி சச் எக்ஸ்பிரஷன் இன் தி எஜுகேஷன் பாலிசி. யூ ரிமெம்பர் வாட் டாக்டர் ராதாகிருஷ்ணன் ஹேஸ் செட் இன் த ஃபர்ஸ்ட் யூனிவர்சிட்டி கமிஷன் ரிப்போர்ட், வாட் லிபரல் எஜுகேஷன் இஸ். ஆல் எஜுகேஷன் இஸ் எக்ஸ்பெக்டட் டு பி லிபரல். ஐ எம் கோட்டிங் ஹிம். It should free us from the shackles of ignorance, prejudice and unfounded belief. If we are incapable of achieving the good life, it is due to faults of our inward being, to the darkness in us. The process of education is the slow conquering of this darkness to lead us from the darkness to light, to free us from every kind of domination, except that for reason is the aim of education. This is Radhakrishnan's University Education Commission's recommendation. This obviously implies that the darkness of ignorance, prejudice and unfounded belief, wherever it may be found, including amongst the socially and educationally disadvantaged classes and those who have been subjected to grossly inhuman deprivations and unjust discrimination, just as scheduled caste, scheduled tribes, has to be eliminated. Not just equality, but freedom itself would lose any meaning and content if such darkness were to pervade amongst large swaths of our people. However, the hierarchical societies marked by endemic inequalities and where hierarchy had ossified, this quote-unquote love of mankind, which was the primary and inherent motive of education as a charitable or a philanthropic occupation, was extended only to individuals who belong to the communities to which such philanthropists belong to. Time, knowledge, and the philosophical constructs that inform our love for mankind change. Even societies in which race was used to impose horrific economic and social conditions on those who belonged to enslaved races have changed. The education policy appears to be suggesting, subject to further intense scrutiny, about the freedoms that could be granted to non-minority educational institutions. Non-minority educational institution claims they ought to have the right to choose only those who have demonstrated a certain level of proficiency in test, where the differences between those who get selected and those who are discarded may be insignificant or do not take into account the impact of differences in social and educational backgrounds on the performance to those tests. This will lead to a very dangerous consequences. What about the reservations? Is there any way shown in the new education policy so far as the reservations are concerned? I don't find any, subject to corrections. Reservations for the socially and educationally backward classes and the scheduled caste and the scheduled tribes would ensure the students from different social, educational, economic and cultural backgrounds get together to study and learn about each other and critically assess the relevance in the manner in which knowledge is generated, disseminated and applied. I don't find any such a place in the new educational policy. Coming back to the question of federalism, federalism at its core is about the impact of scale on the vocation of humanization that is implicit in any program of social justice. The sheer variety of lived experiences, encompassing encoded knowledge of such lived experiences, as well as a culture that such variegated lived experiences create, necessarily questions regarding epistemic injustices in programs and policies that seek to rapidly homogenize. Such epistemic injustices, which will in turn have implications about what issues are prioritized and the distribution of resources, can often become the sources of dehumanization of others and the belittling of the smaller entities. By dispersing collective power, both horizontally and vertically, constitutional structures not merely seek to structure a set of political institutions, but also structure the very mode and manner of social and cultural discourses. A social democracy is necessarily structured to be on the guard against overweening and imperial tendencies of the center. This question transcends this epoch or that epoch. The rule by this man or that group, larger the scale and greater the diversity we seek to implicate in one monotonic conception of the nation, more likely is it we encounter problems of epistemic injustices and the real material consequences. The ontological possibilities of epistemic injustice and history is littered with instances of such illustrations that accompany scale necessarily implies the possibility of strengthening of forces of dehumanization. We need to be very, very cautious about the implications with regard to federal structures and principles. Well, let me end with an expression of hope. Any worthy educational process that is for man, for his or her humanization and self-actualization, can only be based on the principles of fearless interrogation. We are from a culture that had originally dared to wonder whether the Creator himself knows the purpose of that which he created, and went on to wonder whether there is a Creator at all. Somewhere along the way, we lost the capacity to interrogate, and we also learned to make the interrogator fearful. Fear necessarily derogates from the learning experience, as it denigrates the learner's capacity to learn and to further advance knowledge itself. If we are to create a system that promotes the seeking of knowledge fearlessly, let us make a pact today to discuss the draft NEP fearlessly, albeit in a civilized and a humanized manner. That, after all, can be our only vocation. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen, for your forbearance. I'm extremely thrilled to be in the presence of this august audience. I'm grateful to the president and organizers of this conference for giving me this opportunity to share my random thoughts broadly on education and to some extent on the implications of this new educational policy. Thank you once again. Jai Hind.